Ashet Audio presents The Shit Show, an Is It Just Me or Is Everything Shit special, written by Steve Lowe and Alan McArthur, and read by Miles Jupp. Introduction. Why now? Why revisit the world's shitness now? To be honest, if you need to ask that question, you're probably listening to the wrong book here. But let's indulge you, for fuck's sake. In a word, Boris Johnson. Okay, that's two words. And also, identity. Everyone's talking about it. Which is another five words, so that's seven words altogether, you knew that. Moreover, the collective identity embodied in the increasingly tall tale of Jamie Oliver. When the original Is It Just Me or Is Everything Shit came out in 2005, the book established through forensic investigative analysis worthy of Woodward and Bernstein or Classic Panorama that popular media personality of the era, Boris Johnson, was also, it transpired, an ambitious Tory politician. Who knew? Jamie, meanwhile, had been plucked off the mean streets, well, the kitchen of the River Cafe, ask your gran, to become a popular geezer TV chef. He wanted to feed the children. We should all feed the children. Actually, that sounds weird. We should all want the children to be fed. We don't desire to proffer them food ourselves. Look, as long as they get the food and it's all above board, then good. Is It Just Me was about different shit times. Ostensibly boom times. Are booms better than busts? Yes. But not when everyone's mining anything of value for booty, and just kind of shodgying up the world and privatising the fuck out of everything, while pretending the boom will never end. Boom and bust were no more, they said, the arseholes. By the time of Is It Just Me or Has the Shit Hit the Fan in 2009, sadly and entirely unpredictably, the crash had arrived. On skates. Like everyone, Jamie, now a restaurant emperor, was feeling the pinch. The icy pinch of debt. There's been a lot of borrowing going on, mate, he said. He wasn't feeling the icy pinch as much as people who weren't as loaded as him, but still. When the leaders of the G20 nations, totalling 24 nations, gathered in London to bail out the world economy, there could only be one choice of caterer. But Greggs were busy, apparently, so Jamie did it. Have you ever served finger food to a world leader? Jamie has. Sorry, that also sounds wrong in the current climate. He did some cooking for world leaders, all right? Christ, even laid on a spread sounds like the sort of thing you can't say anymore. Boris, meanwhile, was that year cast in EastEnders as the character Mayor of London, and for his second job was the Mayor of London, a city that is, depending on your point of view, either one of the world's very greatest cities or a massive nest of wankers. A tape emerged that year of him offering to provide the address of a journalist to an old pal so he could have the shit kicked out of said journalist. And where is Jamie now, in the Trump and Brexit era, the era of rancour and confused identity and rancour? You've heard of Jamie's Italian. Of course you have. You didn't actually go there, clearly, at least not often, but you're aware of it going belly up. But what of Jamie himself? Jamie has gone back to Essex, from whence he came, looking for himself. Jamie is in flux. Aren't we all? He's taken up residence at the end of Southend Pier, in a confused Brexit town, hovering above contested fishing waters. All that is left of his previous empire is an internet show, put up on YouTube for free, called Jamie and Jimmy's Friday Night Vlog, in which Jamie and a loyal childhood friend sit about making endless cups of tea, dreaming about cooking for celebrities and changing the world with crusading campaigns, just like the old days. See the entry, Is Jamie Oliver Now More Metaphor Than Man? Whatever did happen to Boris Johnson, though? Lorraine Kelly, A Philosophical Disquisition on the Nature of Reality. Is she? Are we? Who is? And where are they? And how long will they be there? Does the universe even exist? These are the sort of essential philosophical questions latterly raised by Lorraine Kelly. Yes, the chatty Scottish lady off of the telly. That Lorraine Kelly, so-called. But is that Lorraine Kelly the real Lorraine Kelly? No. In 2019, Lorraine Kelly established in court that the TV Lorraine Kelly and the real Lorraine Kelly are not, in fact, the same person, and thus Lorraine the person did not have to pay a £1.2 million tax bill from HMRC for monies paid for the services of Lorraine the construct. Yes, it had been her on the telly, but also it hadn't. What is real, anyway? That is the question Lorraine Kelly has posed to humanity and the taxman. Summing up, Judge Jennifer Dean said, "We did not accept that Ms. Kelly simply appeared as herself. We were satisfied that Ms. Kelly presents a persona of herself. Quite simply put, the programmes are entertaining. Ms. Kelly is entertaining. Big fan, Judge Jennifer Dean, big fan. And the DNA of the programmes is the personality, performance, the Lorraine Kelly brand that is brought to the programmes." This gets you thinking. What is this so-called HMRC? All those letters they send, are they real? And those so-called deadlines? Maybe all these concepts, and indeed all concepts, are essentially plastic in nature. Lorraine, or should that be Lorraine, fan Judge Dean went on, "We should make clear we do not doubt that Ms. Kelly is an entertaining lady. I'm not saying Judge Jennifer Dean watches Lorraine on her phone in court. I'm not saying that. She does, though, possibly. But the point is that for the time Ms. Kelly is contracted to perform live on air, she is public Lorraine Kelly. She may not like the guests she interviews. She may not like the food she eats. She may not like the film she viewed. But that is where the performance lies." Maybe everything is slipping. Is she even Scottish? Am I Scottish? I don't think I am. Am I Lorraine? Are you Lorraine? I wrote to Eamon Holmes to ask him if he is real. I didn't get a reply, from which I conclude that Eamon Holmes is not real. Men's Men of Brexit. Brexit is musk to men. Men's men. Maybe it's all that talk of sailing the seas, furiously trading, and perhaps a spot of light piracy, who knows, and white-knuckle no deals. The Tory party and the British right in general have, of course, never been short of hard men. Never mind the Duke of Wellington, even Tory wet and arch-remainer Michael Heseltine once strangled a savage dog to within a whisker of death with his bare hands. His mum's dog. He had to be put down the next day. But the bear pit of Brexit has allowed some proper blokes to step up to the plate and roar. David Davis. Alan Clark, randy Tory man's man, spotted Davis's talent early on, when the SAS part-timer scaled the walls of Clark's medieval castle as an after-dinner dare, strolling around the crumbling ramparts with his hands in his pockets. All these things are true. Spent his time as Brexit secretary mastering Sudoku, rereading Sven Hassel novels, and, ironically, learning Spanish.
Olé!
Mark Francois. The pitbull terrier of the Brexit movement, according to Nigel Farage. Apparently that's a compliment. The vice chair of the European Research Group hit the headlines back in the expenses scandal days. Ah, remember those days. For bloke snack claims. Mars, Twiglets, pot noodles, pepperami, that only just stopped short of a large doner, lamb, not chicken, ripped up an anti-Brexit letter from the CEO of Airbus on live TV, stopping just short of calling him a fucking bosh. Then, just before May's fall, he turned to the press gallery during PMQs, shaking his head and running his finger across his throat like a knife, which seemed a bit much, given the daily death threats to female MPs. Twiglets, though. Man's food. Johnny Mercer. Seems like a fictional character, but isn't. The Tory MP, who was in the army, thinks welfare makes the kids soft, and that they should join the army, like he did. When first elected in 2015, he spent 3 nights a week in his motor cruiser rather than claim expenses while attending Parliament. He probably survived by eating foxes. So far, so ex-military Tory boy. But Mercer simply refuses to exhibit character consistency. Never keen to dwell on his past in the military, Mercer also once did an advert for Dove, showering in the buff. You don't see little Johnny, though. A winning contestant on Celebrity Hunted, Mercer also made an unexpected bid to become a modernist poet with one particular article on Brexit. "The sands are shifting beneath our feet like a runaway horse." What will he get up to next, apart from mentioning he was in the army? Ian Duncan Smith. "Teresa, Teresa, Teresa, out! Out, out." That was him. IDS loves telling shit Tory leaders to go. even used to shout at himself in the mirror back when he was the quiet man, man's man. Another military chap, of course, invented universal credit, a benefits system that exacerbated a hunger crisis, according to Human Rights Watch. The Institute for Government, who support the idea of universal credit, said that the overall effect has been to plunge people already on low incomes into rent arrears and debt, and in some cases homelessness. Brutal. Dominic Raab. Karate, boxing, ripped, could fuck you up. Not taking any nonsense from uppity birds, calling feminists some of the most obnoxious bigots. He backtracked slightly when photographed with his wife in their, her, kitchen for an article on his leadership ambitions. Is she a feminist? He was asked. Is who a feminist? He answered. Tommy Robinson. Definitely hard, as he hangs about with football hooligans. Football lads. The Democratic Football Lads Alliance. Yes, they like football. Yes, they're lads. But at heart, they're just soccer-mad blokes who happen to like hanging out together in a large group or alliance, as they love democracy and aren't keen on Muslims. Nigel Farage. Once called himself Older Women's Crumpet. Sorry. On a side note, Nigel, you don't get to label yourself Crumpet. That's not how it works. Often talks about his big vision for Britain and his big message for Westminster. All right, man, we get it. In July 2019, urged beta Tory MPs to step aside to let his Brexit party beat Labour to a pulp in the car park. Sajid Javid. Inspirational proof that people from Muslim backgrounds have an equal right and an equal ability to be complete arseholes. So tough, he claimed to have grown up on Britain's hardest street in Bristol. Like hosting Britain's hardest pub, this is a claim made by all towns in Britain. Largest roundabout in Europe, mate. That's another one. Jeremy Hunt. Not really. Oft referred to during the Tory leadership contest as the richest man in the cabinet. Yes. But is he happy? Stephen Yaxley Lennon. So hard, they named him twice. Gavin Williamson. As Defence Secretary, sort of casually declared war. Well, wars. That's right, he declared wars. Russia, China, who wants some? Sacked for leaking state secrets, but he swears he never, he was very soon back in the affray as campaign manager for Boris Johnson's leadership bid. Allegedly used strong-arm tactics such as making MPs who said they would vote for Johnson in the secret ballots provide photographic evidence of their ballot paper with the X duly scratched in the right box. It doesn't look that hard, I'll give you that, but they do say it's the quiet ones you need to watch. And the really big ones. Steve Baker. On television, actually said the words, "Everyone knows I'm Brexit hard man Steve Baker." And then, again on television, he started crying. Was he crying about his old mum, how she brought them all up on her own? No, it was in a Brexit documentary talking about how difficult it was to vote against May's deal for the third time, when lesser men, Boris Johnson, Rees-Mogg, IDS, were caving like knaves and cowards. It's okay, mate. Let it all out. Reviews for items on supermarket delivery sites, an important consideration. Peas might seem like small things. I mean, they are small things. But are they any less worthy of proper consideration for all that? If you can't take the little things seriously, are you a serious person? No, you're not a serious person. Basically, whenever I'm eating peas, which I often am, I ponder, quite reasonably, yes, these peas are good. But are they good enough? Even when I'm enjoying my peas, there are suspicions that better peas are out there, somewhere, waiting. I mean, the term existential crisis is overused, but... So I looked into peas. Someone has to. Where is which when you need it? Obsessively testing washing machines, I expect. The endless cycle of washing cycles. So I decided to consult the hive mind. Over at Sainsbury's, I read some positive reports about their own brand garden peas. 4 out of 5. I always keep these in the freezer. I've bought petit pois in the past, but these are just as tasty and so handy for adding to stews, etc. Good idea about the freezer. I'll definitely bear that in mind. And the stews. But mention of petit pois got me thinking. Should I be considering the smaller pea? Turns out the whole petit pois field is a minefield. 1 out of 5. Worst frozen peas I can remember having. Nothing like the texture and flavour of petit pois. Also, they looked like full-size peas. Clicking on other brands, I discovered the scale issue was alarmingly widespread. What's going on here? Petit pois only have to be petit and pois. If they're just pois, they're piss-poor petit pois. I do like pois, but not if they're phony petit pois, plain old pois masquerading as petit pois. It isn't right. Over at Asda, their own brand British Garden Peas were also receiving some mixed responses. 2 out of 5, disappointing, it should be 2.5 minutes in my zapper, but no matter what time I put them in for, they come out mostly tough. Tough peas. That sounds like a phrase. Tough peas. Tough peas, I'm afraid. That's just your tough peas. Go and tough pea yourself. I had to wonder, though, do these peas never go soft? Truly? I mean, that in itself would be kind of extraordinary. Others, however, find that these peas do go soft and do, in fact, make for some very satisfying pea-eating experiences. 4 out of 5. Fab. Just as good as the other makes. Love them, and I love peas, so I should know. Which sounds promising. After all, you do want your peas to be reviewed by pea lovers, albeit discerning ones, not people who simply love all peas. Maybe the other reviewer just didn't like peas. Another poor review noted some inconsistency in the stock. 2 out of 5. I bought a bag of these a few weeks ago and was amazed how beautiful they were. Amazed by how beautiful they were. Respect is due. We're definitely dealing with someone who can appreciate a pea there. And beauty. But it's still so contradictory. I needed some consistency, some cohesion. So I went to Ocado. I know it's decadent, but sometimes only the overpriced pea will do. But even here, checking out the reviews for their own brand petit pois, I found the same extreme responses to peas. 1 out of 5. I didn't think that it was possible to dislike peas, but these petit pois are revolting. They taste revolting. They are hard and just plain horrible. So even at Ocado, pea hardness is an issue. What is going on? Then I thought, maybe this reviewer didn't know that frozen peas need to be cooked. We've all made that mistake when we're starting out. Then I was momentarily swayed back in the other direction by this opinion. 5 out of 5. Lovely and sweet. Only peas my son will eat. Which even rhymes. Perhaps unintentionally, perhaps not. But then I started thinking about how many pea types this boy, or who knows, man, had to taste before hitting on this particular variety. Not these ones. No, no, not these either. We must keep going, Mother. We will find them. And what could have been so very much amiss with all those other peas? Was I wrong to embark on this journey of discovery? Still the questions came. Even worse than before. Why this pea? Why not that pea? La nausea! La nausea! At this point, I just thought, I can't deal with all this anymore. I'm not even going to buy any peas, you know. Maybe I've had it with peas. Looking forward to having your tea at mine, as you know there will be peas. There won't be now. But hey, tough peas. The film production slate of Brian May and Roger Taylor, film producers. Buoyed by the enormous global success of Oscar-winning biopic Bohemian Rhapsody, Queen stalwarts Brian May and Roger Taylor decided to take a well-earned break from playing the guitar on the roof of public buildings and all those niggling attendant health and safety issues to bring more great stories to the silver screen / iPhone. But some churlish people have questioned Bohemian Rhapsody's verisimilitude. Is this reality? Is this just an approximation thereof? Were Queen really playing that song on that particular tour? It doesn't matter. Was Freddie's moustache quite right? Who cares? And of course, one particularly controversial issue. In real life, Mercury was plagued by rumours that he might be an homosexual, something subtly alluded to in the film when Freddie mentions he quite likes disco. Here we exclusively reveal the exciting projects that Brian and Roger have in development. Stonewall. A group of friends are relaxing in the sun-kissed garden of a home county's harvester when the police arrive unexpectedly. Don't they always? The local special constable asks the friends if they're having a nice time, which they are. Milk. Aptly named dairy farmer Harvey Milk enters the regional butter championships. Will his whey curdle in time? The naked civil servant. Happily married Department of Health and Social Care clerk Quentin Crisp gets on top of his filing. Blue is the warmest colour. Interior decorator Adele French Lady just got serious. She's French. Long, bravura, authentic sequences of choosing colours from a colour chart, exactly how interior decorators choose colours from a colour chart, and not how other people like to get off on how interior decorators choose colours from a colour chart. Brokeback Mountain. Two 1960s Wyoming sheephands go about their business. Just to be clear, their business handling livestock. Pride. A group of motivational speakers travel to South Wales to help local teenagers with their self-esteem. The miners reciprocate by coming to London to say thank you. Oranges are not the only fruit. Greengrocer Big Jim Winterson makes sure to offer a wide range of stock. Kiwis aren't the half of it. Even when it comes to citrus, you've got to cover all the options these days, he counsels. People expect you to carry easy peelers. My Beautiful Laundrette. Working together to live the new 80s Thatcherite dream by charging people money to wash their clothes, Omar and Johnny briefly wonder if there might be more to their relationship. But of course, there isn't. It all comes out in the wash. How they laugh. Ask Greta. The Greta Thunberg-inspired climate actions push the environment to the top of the agenda, where it belongs. But the media, both mainstream and social, just had to canonise her, turning her into some sort of medieval icon, and became obsessed with her in ways that are slightly beyond comprehension. Within a couple of weeks, they were asking her how to deal with Brexit. Give her a break, she is 16. Here are some other genuine questions genuinely asked of the Swedish school student. Greta, does God exist? Greta, who invented punk? Greta, why do the Americans pronounce aluminium the way they do? It's wrong and it's really annoying. Greta, which country is home to the most camels? Greta, what is time? Is time travel possible, at least in theory? Greta, if half x plus half x open brackets half x plus half open brackets half x plus half open brackets half plus recurring equals y, then x equals what? Greta, in terms of diseases that affect the elderly, how much of their origin is biological and how much can be ascribed to social reasons? And what do we need to do about it? Greta, I have a two-part question. First, what is beauty? And also second, what is truth? Greta, Edison or Tesla? I don't understand the question. You heard. Greta, can blind people see in their dreams? By the way, Malala does ads for Apple now. Fact. I mean, she does other stuff too, obviously, but she does do that. Donald Trump, the literature. So it looks as though the presidency of Donald Trump will end up inspiring more books than that of almost any other president, many of whom could actually read books. Should Trump inspire books, rather than, say, bumper stickers? All these Trump works do make sense, though, if you consider that Donald Trump is essentially a fictional creation. Yes, he's technically non-fiction, but he was certainly predicted by fiction. Orwell's 1984, Sinclair Lewis's It Couldn't Happen Here, The Simpsons, all these and more predicted Trump's rise. OK, only The Simpsons actually predicted that Donald Trump would be elected president. To be honest, Orwell was way out on the specifics there. But anyway, as the stories attest, Trump had to happen. A hulking embodiment of dumbass America, a bragging, burger-munching cartoon imbecile elbowing his way to the top job, having honed his playground bully routine on reality TV. That was never not going to happen. Did you honestly think you'd get through your life without America electing Trump? You knew this was coming. Nothing is inevitable, of course it isn't. But this was. Many varied works by wildly different creators are now available from all good bookstores, each one examining similar scenes from different perspectives, a bit like the Gospels, although we perhaps shouldn't get too carried away with the parallels to Jesus. Trump has already started to resemble one of those legendary characters endlessly reinterpreted through the ages, a little like Robin Hood, although we shouldn't get too carried away with the parallels to Robin Hood. For this reason, I've now read every single book about Donald Trump, from beginning to end, without skimming the boring bits or the footnotes, and shall now dispense the wisdom gleaned about Donald Trump through the lens of the literature on Donald Trump, which he himself will not read, even though his name features all the way through. Some of the books about Donald Trump that Donald Trump will not read are the books that Donald Trump wrote. Except he didn't write them because Donald Trump can't write. But he can pay other people to write books by Donald Trump. In 2011, Trump wrote, didn't write, an erotically charged blockbuster called Trump Tower, concerning all the dirty, dirty things people would do for a condo in the gold-plated skyscraper. The cover features the titular construction thrusting darkly into the sky. You could read this as a symbol akin to the 2001 monolith, an inscrutable pillar evoking everything and nothing, man's evolution, humanity's quest for a higher power, the eternal mysteries. I suggest that you do read it like this. The alternatives are not great. But the most famous book, not by Donald Trump, is still his 1980s bestseller, The Art of the Deal, which dispenses key tips on how to succeed in real estate. He pours scorn, for instance, on the whole concept of location, location, location. You don't necessarily need the best location, you just need the best deal. Don't worry, he doesn't pour scorn on the program, location, location, location. He's not a monster. Has ghostwriter Tony Schwartz any regrets? Yes, he's had quite a few, actually. He now feels horribly culpable for birthing the central Trump mythos, and has called him terrifying, a scared child who is frightened by black people, and who lacks any abiding values or genuine feelings for another living soul. And he should know. He is Trump. Or was. Couldn't he have expressed these concerns through the text, though, by way of warning? I don't necessarily expect, by the way, guys, I'm a terrified racist who can't even love my own children, but maybe some hint somewhere. So if you read carefully between the lines, you might infer that the narrator character was a terrified racist who can't even love his own children. But frankly, who's got time for that? Then there are the insider accounts of the Trump White House, which, viewed together, convey a new hell, where the only possible emotion is hate. Everyone hates the president hates everyone else, and everyone else hates each other and themselves. You know the expression, there's a lot of love in the room? Well, there isn't in those rooms. For the sake of brevity, let us distill some of these tell-all works to one key insult. Cliff Sims, vipers. James Comey, chronic liar. Bob Woodward, nervous breakdown of executive power. Chris Christie, selfish. Subtle but damning, that last one. In her book Unhinged, former aide Omarosa Manigault Newman claimed that Trump privately wondered to her if he might be sworn in not on the traditional Bible, but on the greatest business book of all time, The Art of the Deal. She advised him not to mention this idea to anyone else. We laughed. He wanted me to believe he was kidding. He wasn't kidding. If nothing else, though, swearing on this one book that meant something to him would at least have been honest. And it does show a level of regard for the printed word that I, for one, find surprising. In the context of everything that has happened both before and since, would not the sight of Trump swearing an oath on The Art of the Deal by Donald Trump at least have been one gesture worthy of respect? No? Even in the loosest sense of the word, no? Anyway, most famous of all is Fire and Fury by Michael Wolff, a journalist who gave the year-long impression of being a White House sofa cushion. They actually let him just sit and watch them for a year, taking notes. Don't mind me, I'm a sofa cushion, he basically said, for a year, to the morons. Among the many juicy takeaways from his account, I personally favour the revelation that National Security Advisor H.R. McMaster was fired for talking monotonously. That guy bores the shit out of me, Trump declared, damningly. Shouldn't someone have pointed out that McMaster's security briefings were not, strictly speaking, meant to be viewed as entertainment? I'm not suggesting that they should have been intentionally boring, but even if they were, this should not, in and of itself, have been a problem. You do have to wonder whether the president was going into these security briefings with the right set of expectations. Then there are the cases for the defence. Given that there is no defence of Trump that possibly works in the realm of linguistic communication as understood and used by rational humans, you sometimes have to wonder what these writers are trying to achieve. Although in the case of convicted fraudster Conrad Black, jailed for siphoning cash from his media empire, you don't have to wonder for long. On the publication of his lickspittle tome, Donald J. Trump, A President Like No Other, he means it in a good way, he quickly achieved a presidential pardon. Then there is Understanding Trump by Newt Gingrich, architect of the Clinton-era fightback against liberal values in favour of bigotry and hate, not his words, he called it the war, which compares Trump to acknowledged national heroes like Abraham Lincoln and General George Marshall. Flattering, but it does also genuinely feel like he's taking the piss. I like to think that this is the first in a series of Newt Gingrich understanding books, and that he's currently working on Newt Gingrich, Understanding Love. Then there is Fox News presenter and one-time district attorney Judge Jeanine Pirro's offering, Liars, Leakers and Liberals, the alliterative title cunningly conveying the idea of a liberal wetting themselves and then blaming someone else, like they do, they totally do. In March 2019, Fox News was forced to suspend Pirro's show after she made Islamophobic comments on air. If Fox News thinks you've gone too far, then it's really very likely that you've gone too far. In this work, she castigates the deep state conspiracy against Trump and paints him as an all-round nice guy who doesn't hate immigrants at all. Does Donald Trump hate immigrants? No, absolutely not. Her crowning piece of evidence? The Trump Tower employees I spoke with who have foreign accents talked about what a great employer he is. Case closed. Nice one, Judge. I wouldn't recommend this as your first book in case it puts you off reading all other books, but it does raise important questions, like where exactly the hell is this deep state when you need it? Hello, anti-democratic forces of the night! Anyone home? Not that I'm into that kind of thing normally, but maybe, just this once, pull some shadowy cabal shit and just get him out of there. I'm now actually starting to wonder, what if there is a deep state, and it's just quite shit at getting stuff done? Then there are the Trump religious texts, bearing titles like The Faith of Donald J. Trump, a spiritual biography, called A Very Interesting Read by none other than Donald Trump, who was presumably fascinated to find out about his spiritual beliefs when it was read out to him. The link between Trump and evangelical Christianity sure is a strange one, what with him being the living embodiment of all sins ever. It turns out that some Christians are quite bad people. I know, it makes no sense. But as Jesus himself shruggingly declared, if thou canst not beat them, thou shouldst join them. To be fair, the authors do tussle with the notion of this billionaire playboy having any moral dimension, but they reason that, during all his pleasure-seeking exploits, Trump has not lived apart from religion. In this regard, he is very American. In his stinking hypocrisy, he's sort of an all-American hero. I guess there's a certain argument to be made. If Jesus died for all our sins, how much must he have died for Trump's sins? Jesus is probably still dying out there somewhere for Trump's sins. Then there is the Trump Prophecies by Prophet Mark Taylor, a retired Florida firefighter who was told by God in 2011 that Trump would become president. And you thought he was just chosen by the Russians and shadowy right-wing data miners. This raises another unsettling question. If God did indeed choose Trump to be president, what kind of God is God? This tale was even adapted into a film by the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.